All right, welcome back to the summer school. My name is Julian Konkel and I'm a professor at the University of Göttingen. And I will be talking about I/O and middleware, continuing the nice session that you had in the morning and providing a little bit more context. Feel free to put any question you may have into the chat at any time and I will answer that promptly. I think it's very important to understand this very important topic of I/O. Note that this session is split into two pieces. So I'll give the first piece, which is about I/O and middleware, and then you will get a talk by Sadi, who will talk about NetCDF CF, what it is in a minute, in a couple of minutes. So this talk is outlined as follows. First, I give a motivation, why is I/O so important? Then we talk a little bit more about I/O, potential I/O solutions on the different levels. And then we have a very important topic, which is the theory, or a little bit of theory and a model for I/O performance, such that you are able to assess performance better. Lastly, we talk about NetCDF a little bit because that leads us into the lab. So the lab is already uploaded and you can do that after, you know, our two sessions, my session and the session of study is completed. And I'll be there online all the time, but basically the lab is pre-recorded, allowing you to make your own progress and ask me questions while I'll be available. Good. I'm not talking about learning objectives. So what is I/O in general? So input-output, what as far as it concerns this talk, is we talk about data migration between memory and storage. That requires us to somewhat serialize the data that is in memory to something like files or objects on persistent storage, which means it can be stored there for a long time. By memory, the data would be gone once you leave the turn the computer off or quit your program. Note that I/O is very complicated and an important operation because without I/O, you don't get any versatile, useful output that you need, any results of your simulations and applications. And it's also complicated in the sense that the achievable throughput of storage is often quite much smaller than memory and by orders of magnitude, as we will see. Secondly, it is very costly to keep data on storage but not use it. And lastly, this performance issue, that if you are able to get some performance on the storage and you do that not perfectly right, you can easily get a 100x worse performance than if you would do it optimally. So it means you can improve your performance often by 100x by doing it correctly. So here we see on the Titan supercomputer at Oak Ridge National Laboratory the potential throughputs that we can achieve on these different layers. So in computation layer, so in the CPUs, we can actually move around about 125 petabytes per second. But in the node memory, you can only cover 4.5 petabytes a second. Then if you go over the network, you have 24 terabytes per second, which is about 1/50th of the node memory. And lastly, if you go to storage, you then get basically 5% of the internet connect performance. So that means overall, as you can see, we basically have about a factor of 10,000 here between those, or 100,000, I think, 100,000 between those storage and the available computation. So we must be very careful. I also wanted to quickly show you this performance variability or variance if you do it not correctly. Here what we see is for a different number of nodes that run a benchmark, and this benchmark is optimal in the sense that it does do the I/O to achieve the optimal performance. But what we see if we pick one configuration such as 100 nodes, we see these different data points. And these different data points are about 4 to 8x different by just changing the configuration. So again, if I pick a wrong configuration, I get a performance maybe here of about 32 gigabytes per second, while I could get about 130, 150 gigabytes a second performance if I do it correctly. Again, I think a 4 to 8x performance gain by doing the right thing is a low hanging fruit that everyone should be able to achieve. So, but of course it requires us to understand a little bit of configuration. So lastly, just to mention, every time you move from one system to another, And here we see over the different years, the performance growth here for from DKRZ for the different generations. And we see also in terms of storage capacity and storage throughput the growth. And just believe me, you get about compute time growth of about 20x every 5 years. Well, maybe it's slowing down recently, but the storage, it's about 6x. So you have to this kind of increasing gap. And of course, that means you have to be careful what you are writing. And lastly, IO systems cost a lot of money. So here's you see the budget. So the compute part of DKRZ was maybe about 16 million, but the storage was 7.5 million. And network is 5 million. So you can see it's already here. It was bigger than the network costs. So we have to really take care of what we want to save, store, and input. So let's next talk a bit, little bit more about IO. As we saw, IO capacity on current HPC system may not be sufficient, and the trend is getting worse. And of course, it's very important to do IO, because if you cannot write data, you cannot analyze it, and then that way you lose science. So it would be optimal from the science perspective if you would be able to store the full spatiotemporal resolution of your model or whatever program you run. However, often we have to make trade-offs when we do the storage, because we simply cannot afford to wait that long to dump all this data out. Also, in terms of energy consumption and cost, of course, like I said, storing idle data costs energy, and it is costly also in terms of money. Because if I use my data quickly and if I analyze it quickly, it doesn't have to be stored so long. And that way, it's, of course, more efficient, because I need less storage, right? And that storage costs money. So in order to make good as a user, and I would say to be a very good user, you should understand a little bit basics of the IO stack, should understand the kind of access paradigms that you're doing, what parallel access means, and lastly, what happens under the hood, how does the system split my data across servers? So here we see a typical IO stack. We have here application side libraries. It could be like a weather forecast, climate simulation, and so on. Sometimes we see domain-specific solutions such as XIOS that serve the purpose to optimize IO inside the application to distribute the data more efficiently. Then we have high-level IO libraries. They are often called also middleware, because they sit between the application and the parallel file system or object storage. And those high-level IO libraries, here if we talk about NetCDF particularly, they expose domain-specific interfaces, and they provide self-describing structured files, portable files, and they may provide some high-level optimizations. So then in this IO middleware layer, here MPIO as an example, we see some software that matches the programming model, such as MPI. And this purpose of this layer is to efficiently map operations to file systems, and it may be used here by those layers on top, of course. Lastly, we have the parallel file system that manages all our available storage hardware or storage media. By storage media, I mean something like a hard disk drive, an SSD flash drive, or some non-volatile memory, for example. On this layer, data just looks like an array of bytes. So you talk about a file, we talk about objects that consist of an array of bytes. So we see that the semantic layer is lost, and that is often a problem to optimize it on the low level. And that's why we have to optimize the data before it hits those lowest levels. In terms of a single process, we can have different access patterns. So here we see the memory representation of our data. You can think of it here as a one-dimensional matrix, for example, it is stored. How do I map this to a file? Where I could do this blockwise. I could also have the situation that it is contiguous in memory, but in the file it is split. For example, if you have of a 2D matrix, you have only a couple of columns. Yeah, and those columns need to be stored, and then you have some sparsity here inside the file. You can also have it in memory as sparse memory representation, and you can have both in a mixed fashion. Then we have a bursty behavior. That means over time, what will happen is that I store some data, a large chunk of data, for example, the current representation. Then I do some additional computation and I store the next piece of data. Then I, and there are kind of gaps. So there are gaps in which I do activity and then I pause and I don't do activity. Lastly, there's this out of core model, which means I need more data than it fits into my memory. So I kind of map that into files. And then from these files, I pick the data that I just process in memory for a time, and then it gets synced back to the file. So it kind of is here a big extension. This is very slow oftentimes. So we need to be careful. Also the contiguous in memory, not in file, is also slow. So anything that is not contiguous in the file in general is slow and should be prevented. Now, when we talk about a parallel program, still what we find is a lot of programs, they use the serial I/O or master only, sometimes called mode, which means all the processes of my parallel program, they talk to one dedicated process that then dumps it into one file. This is obviously a problem because you are limited by the network performance of the single client, as we will see, and that is very slow. And parallel file systems, they have the term parallel in them because they are most suitable if you have each of these processes do I/O independently. And there are two ways of dealing with this issue. First of all, each of these processes could write their own file. That brings then another challenge because the number of files can be absolutely overwhelming. If we talk here about 10,000 of processes, then you would get 10,000 files, which is challenging. And lastly, that's why we have so-called shared files, which means all these processes, they access a single file and have somehow partitioned the portions inside this file across them. So that's the most preferred way. And oftentimes we see also a mixed way between this and this parallel shared file access that provides the best performance. But it is challenging to code as a user slash programmer. So lastly, let's have a look how the data is actually stored by parallel file systems. So what will happen is you will have multiple servers. For example, in Lustre, they are called object storage targets. And now we have inside our processes, we have our data. And what we want to do, for example, is we want to store pieces of this data as process zero into our available storage. And what can happen is that these pieces, they go to exactly one server. Sometimes, like here for process one, what will happen is that the data that we want to access, it is belonged to multiple of those servers. So basically we have to think of, we have now two sides. We have the processes, which are the clients that have some kind of data representation, some kind of data sharing inside of their memory, right? So each of them has different data. And the same happens for the storage servers as well. And it's of course very important that such a mapping fits quite well, because if one client here needs to talk to many servers at the same time, it can also be a cause of contention. Yeah, but this prop is often not seen by the user. And at the end, logically, what we will have all the time is we have a single file, for example, that starts at some offset zero, and then it's just an array of bytes, right? That is goes on as big as you can make it, as you like it. And we have to somehow, from the client side, put the data into this representation, which is a challenge itself. So let's go on to I/O solutions. As we saw, as we move toward exascale, and we are actually there in terms of machine learning already, and the gap between compute power and I/O bandwidth widens further. So we have to kind of optimize this. We have to make good use of our storage hardware. And there are three lines of optimization or three levels that we can do on application level, at middleware level, and at hardware level. So let's talk a bit about application level. So I would say it's the most important aspect is that users that program, they have to design the I/O they are doing from the application carefully, because it is the most important factor. So you should do a few large requests, dumping memory from the processes in parallel, selecting an appropriate data model, like potentially NetCDF. And if you are not doing this, you will get much significant worse performance. Here's an example. If you have two programs that use the just regular POSIX operations to write 60K of data on a standard laptop, if you write every byte individual with an I/O call, you get 0.1 megabyte per second, despite all the optimizations that are in place. If you do it by dumping this whole data at once, you will see effectively 100 megabyte per second or maybe byte. So that is about 500 times faster. And this is just a single local application. Yeah. Lastly, on application level, what we see more and more if we move to our large scale analysis is so-called in situ analysis, which means that then instead of writing all the data out into a file and then in a post-processing analyze these files, generating further data products, what we are doing is we kind of identify a priori what kind of analysis we'd like to do. Then we encode this in a program, and then while our application is running, it generates those data products for us, and then we just look at those data products. PowerView is such a tool that you will get to know, learn during this summer school that provides such an option. There are their own challenges in terms of performance if you do such a kind of a model, but I think it is really a good complement to the mode that where you just dump the data and analyze it up a posteriori. Okay, so on a hardware level, there are now some new technology coming up, like non-volatile memory. What does this mean? Well, it behaves like memory, but it also has the term non-volatile, which means even after the power is out, the data is stored and safely there. Also, what we see coming up as terms is so-called byte addressable storage. That means instead of storage media where you have to access large chunks of data, like 4 kilobytes, yeah, so that means you can only transfer 4 kilobytes. You cannot just transfer a single byte normally on a hard disk drive or on flash storage. Here you can really, like in memory, you can access a certain byte and you can change the content of this byte, which has its certain advantages. The disadvantage is that it's not easy to use. And of course, it's a kind of new program. It requires new programming models. In terms of performance, those are between main memory and some persistent storage like flash oftentimes. So it's a bit slower than in memory, but it has still very high performance. You find also the term NVRAM, which means non-volatile random access memory. I'm not talking much about this because that's really kind of a trend that we see emerging. It also is expensive. So on the hardware level, what we can also see is so-called burst buffers. What do burst buffers do? Well, they try to absorb bursts of dispersed access patterns where we have processes to dump data and then they are computing again, and then they dump data again, which is the result and so on. So the burst buffer tends to absorb this. And typically, they have very fast storage devices, such as non-volatile memory or flash-based SSDs. And they really exploit this application behavior. It's, however, needs to be integrated into your workflow, and it's often not easy to be used because it requires the user to modify their workflow. But lastly, we have middleware. Middleware is between application and system, like I said. And they are often close to the application because we try to exploit domain knowledge. We try to create some data models to simplify for the user this abstraction of it's just a file with an array of bytes. We try to get higher level. And also we try to exploit the parallelization approach. Just to mention, Adios is now a very popular mode because it allows you at runtime, or basically when you run your application, you can change the I/O transports. So you can say, I want to dump it, use in situ visualization, or I want to dump it into persistent storage. Also, NetCDF is a very popular middleware level that we talk about as part of the summer school because it's really popular for climate and weather. And I would say in terms of history, NetCDF had a long time the focus to be compatible so that you can ensure you can exchange data with your peers, other experts in this area. Lately, there have been a lot of efforts to really improve performance, and it's still ongoing efforts because it turned out that this is really important to support performance. Something to be mentioned as part of the EasyVest project is the Earth System Data Middleware, which has also a backend for NetCDF. And it is an approach where we try to get scalable data management practice, where we address this, the issue of inhomogeneous storage stack. That means that you can use multiple storage devices at the same time, like SSDs and disk-based system. You want to exploit them at the same time instead of shifting data manually between them. Yeah, and it's about data conversion and merging. I just wanted to mention this. So this is a little add. So now let's talk about I/O performance, which is a topic very dear to me because oftentimes users lack knowledge here. So the basic problem is when you observe a measurement, right? We see something with Darshan, for example, a runtime. Then we ask, is this runtime appropriate or not? So basically our question is the I/O efficient or inefficient? And also our second question is, what best case performance do we expect? All right, so if our best case performance is X and we are close to X, then we are probably satisfied. But if we are only 1% of X, then this is rather inefficient and we should kind of work on this issue. So there are different ways to support such kind of performance analysis that we should do as a user. We heard about Darshan, which is a tool to identify I/O pattern and assess the performance manually. There are also other tools that are nowadays used by data centers, such as Grafana. With Grafana, you see dashboards. You can see what throughput you have achieved with your application. Still, in both cases, the problem is what is good or bad performance. Therefore, we need to have some models in simulation, starting from trivial models to more complicated models. And we will talk today about a simple model, I would say, that covers 90% that the user needs to know. We will basically look at the communication between different machines in an application and the limitations imposed by network and the I/O performance. So this is really a theoretic limit. We can also augment such a theoretic limit by looking at benchmarks, which is this best case number that we can achieve when running a synthetic workload. And often this is provided by data centers as well, so we can use those numbers. So first, in order to apply such a model, we need some HPC knowledge about our cluster. We know an HPC cluster typically consists of high-end components with an extra fast interconnect. That means we get typically near full bisection bandwidth of the network, which means that if I partition my network into two parts, so I have clients and servers, for example, all of them can pairwise communicate with the maximum throughput of a single link. So let's have a look what this means. So here we have typically our nodes, which means an independent server, and they are connected to the network over some kind of switch. And those links here, they have some kind of bandwidth. For example, here, 56 gigabits per second, just as an assumption. Then we have a switch, and this switch then is connected to other switches in some way. There are many of these kind of network topologies that you can build. Here's a very simple topology, which means that if this node here wants to communicate with this node here, it needs to communicate with the switch. The switch communicates with this switch, the switch communicates with this switch, and the data goes into this node. Okay, so typically the storage, shared storage and servers, they are connected to some basics of such a tree here. And here we have them on the top level, which is quite unusual, but it's just an example. That means if I want to do I/O, the nodes have to go through this switch. And now here, when we do the communication, such a switch, it may have limitations. We talk about blocking factors, for example, or just bisection bandwidth. So that means in this example, we could say, for example, the switch here, it can take only 50 nodes. So if it, more than 50 nodes here on the top try to communicate over this link here, then this link here will be saturated as an example. And then every, if you have the 51 node over here, then you basically just get the same performance. So that is a typical limitation. And yeah, now we have the storage here, and the storage might be somehow connected, and you may have multiple links. But overall, every cluster has some kind of such a structure. And we can talk here about maximum throughput here in a weird number, 56 gigabit, like I said. And we can talk about latency, which I'll do in a minute. Okay, so the simple model that I want to advocate for you is start with your application and think and look at what the application produces. Typically, your application produces one or more files of a certain size. That is easy to obtain. Secondly, you know the number of nodes your job runs. Is it 10 nodes? Is it 100 nodes or something? Lastly, you know the runtime of your job. And even better, if you know the time for the I/O of your job. Yeah, this can be typically obtained with simple timings, and some of your applications that they provide already some way of getting the runtime of I/O. Now compute the observed throughput, TPO, in maybe bytes per second per node, or in GB bytes or something like that per node. So we know then how much data we can actually transfer per node per second. And if this number is very much smaller than the network throughput per node, then there might be an I/O problem. Now, this is a very simple case. Here's an example. So if I have a file size of 10 gigabyte, I have 10 nodes, 10 seconds, I calculate the throughput. So 10 gigabyte divided by 10 nodes and 10 seconds means I get per node about 100 megabyte per second throughput. Now we have to put this number into perspective of what we can theoretically do. So if we have a gigabit Ethernet, which is very old fashioned, but just as a kind of a baseline, this can deliver about 125 megabytes per second. And yeah, you can say 100 megabyte compared to 125 megabyte, that's quite close, right? So this is probably about 80% of the peak throughput. So that's really good, you are done. However, in nowadays in the clusters, we have InfiniBand systems that deliver more than 6 gigabytes per second. And now we can see the 0.1 gigabytes per second, basically we get only 1/60th of the performance. And then this may be an indicator of an issue. Yeah, but this is a very simple model. And why do I bring this up? Yeah, I had a lot of chats with users that tell me, oh, I/O is such a problem. And then you do such a model. Yeah, and they claim the system, it's the fault of the system. You do such a very primitive model, and then you get out as a result that the throughput per node is maybe 3 kilobyte per node per second. Okay, so we are not talking about megabyte, not talking about gigabyte, we are talking of 1/1000000th of a gigabyte. And then they have enormous I/O times, and then you know something is fishy, and something with the I/O accesses needs to be optimized, maybe looking at logs like Dasha and other profiling tools and analysis tools and so on.
Can I ask a small question?
Of course.
The time to transfer the data, 10 seconds, this estimation comes from which transmission instrument.
Yes, okay, so there are two answers, right? The first number that I would always compute is, I would compute how much runs my application. Okay, assume the application runs just 10 seconds, then you can fill in this number. Okay, that is the very coarse-grained number you can get. Often, like I said, you have applications that actually provide a number for I/O and separate compute time from I/O time. And then if this tells you my application computed run over all 100 seconds and 10 seconds I was doing I/O, then you fill in 10 seconds for Aho, right? But if you don't have it, just take this general number. If you run with Darshan, you will also see these IO times and such, so you can fill in those numbers as well. Yeah, this is really, we can start very coarse-grained and then can refine all those numbers as we like, okay?
Okay, very good. Thanks.
Okay, lastly, we can also look at latency. What is latency? That's the time between sending a message and arrival at receiver side. Latency in terms of storage means when you try to do a metadata operation, like I want to create a file, how long does this take? And here you can do the same idea. You can know the number of IO calls you made. For example, I need to create 10,000 files and it takes 1 second. So the throughput is 10,000 files per second, which is probably quite good. And you can compare this also with the latency of your network, and then you know how close you are. It's much more difficult with network latency because there is a huge variance between the different storage systems, how capable they are. Okay, so that's basically the idea for these models. And of course, the core idea of all the storage layers is that they try to hide the I/O penalty because, it, like we said, it's very costly. And depending on the storage media, you have additional costs. So typical strategies are to cache the data. So you allow the application to continue while I/O completes in the background. It's kind of called right behind strategy. It also allows you to aggregate smaller operations into larger operations. And this requires memory. Basically, you can dump the application memory into a separate region. And at this point, then you would start draining this data from memory to storage while you continue with the computation. Additional problem here is that when you overlap computation, communication, and I/O, then I/O requires as well communication, so you need get some kind of interference. Yeah? You can read data from the disk before it's needed. It's called read ahead. The issue that I see being more than 10 years in this area of I/O research, analysis, and optimization is that all those optimizations that you talk about, they typically hide a little bit what's going on, and they have trigger points at which the behavior drastically changes. So you may say, my strategy is now great, I get high performance. Now you run with one more process, or you change your file size a little bit, and suddenly your performance is so much worse. The reason is that some of those things may be turned off because data doesn't fit into memory anymore and stuff like that, and that makes it really hard to analyze. So there has always been this kind of challenge to optimize on your behalf, compared to doing it manually, but I would say manual optimization is not suitable for end users. But really, you need to discuss these things with your data center to make sure that you make good use. And now you have a model that helps you to assess the performance. Lastly, in terms of programming, we heard a little bit about this in the morning. You should overlap I/O with computation. Sometimes that's actually slower. So I would always start with non-overlapping mode and then comparing it. And I would say I/O and communication comes almost for free if you do this kind of overlapping and if you have a good model. But you certainly need to optimize file formats and the access pattern, which is really complicated. Speaking now about middleware, we talked briefly about NetCDF. Now I want to go in further details. What is NetCDF? Well, it's a data model, it's a file format, and it's actually a set of APIs and libraries for various programming languages. So together, they all allow you to share your scientific data such that you can give the same file to someone else who can read it on a different machine and get the same information out of it. So NetCDF allows you to describe multidimensional data and include metadata that describes this data further. And yeah, the APIs are available for most programming languages, and it's largely used in geosciences. So let's talk about the classic NetCDF model. So we have in NetCDF dimensions, variables, and global attributes, or attributes in general. So a NetCDF file, also talking about a data set, is somewhere stored on a system. So it has a path name, It can have different dimensions, variable, global, which are file-level attributes, and data values. So let's look into all of those components. So what is a dimension? So a dimension specifies the shape, grid, and coordinate systems. One dimension has a name and a length. So like you can say time 100. Okay, so that means you have 100 steps or discrete values in this dimension of time. You can do the same for longitude, latitude, and height, and so on. You will use these dimensions to index other quantities, such as maybe the station you are working. I'm talking about station 5, or the model run. This is model run 10. The same dimension can be used in multiple variables. So let's talk about variables. So variables hold data values. So you have a multidimensional array of values of the same type. So you can have a 2D shape, a 1D shape such as time, or a 3D shape, or even 4D, 5D, and so on. Classic NetCDF has only a limited amount of types of data that you can store in it, that you can see here. I'm not going here into this. And a variable has always a name. It has a type. It has this kind of shape. And it can have additional attributes. And lastly, of course, you have values naturally. So let's have a look how we store the data. For example, here we have a three-dimensional data set that we want to store. So we have a time series of x and y values, for example. And then we see, of course, we have something at time one. We have a 2D data set at time two. We have kind of this 2D shape and so on. You can have, like I said, 3D, 4D, and whatever you want. You can even have a 1D variable, but then it's a single value, which is kind of fun. So now a very important concept of NetCDF is coordinate variables. So if you have a 1D variable that has the same name as a dimension, it's called a coordinate variable. So before we talked about something like time, and we said, I have 50 time steps. The problem is, of course, what does it mean to be time step zero? What time is that actually mean? Or what is time step one? Is this 1 second later? So what we can do, we create additional variable. And this variable, we call, give it the same name. So it's called time, for example. And now we can actually store something. We can store, for example, time step zero means 0 seconds of my experiment. Time step one means 12 seconds. And time steps two and whatever. So I can save sort of the values that this index represents in my array additionally. The same for longitude and latitude, of course, because you may want to have 2.5 degrees and as latitude as a resolution. Yeah, most programs that you're using that read NetCDF files automatically recognize these coordinate variables and make their association. But this is already some kind of semantics that is implied here, in which we see more in NetCDF CF by Sadi's talk. So next we can have attributes, which are a metadata about our individual variables. So you can have, for example, temperature, and then you can say, well, my unit for temperature is degrees Celsius. I can save something if the value is minus 99 degrees, then it actually means it's undefined what value this is. I can say it has a certain standardization name like air temperature for this variable. So you can define any of such properties, but if you use standards and NetCDFCF, which means the climate and forecast extensions, provides you a set of well-defined of those attributes that you can set on each of the variables and on the global file. And this really is used by applications to interpret the data that you're reading to make sure that you have a proper semantical use of this data model. Yeah, because it's, as we said here, right, what is temperature? Temperature 5, is it degrees Celsius? Is it Fahrenheit? How is there some kind of conversion offset and what have you? All of this can be kind of set. And that's why those standards are very important, because they allow the programs to interpret the data correctly. So next, In terms of attributes, yeah, I said most of these things. Okay, attributes are scalars or 1D arrays, and they cannot be multidimensional. You can have global attributes or variable attributes that apply to a specific individual variable. Yeah, and this netcdf conventions, that means that not convention doesn't mean it's not necessarily it's a standard, but it's like a standard, a de facto standard. They are often defined in terms of these attributes, like I mentioned, netcdf cf. So here's a UML diagram of the classic netcdf model. So we have files. It consists of dimensions, variables, and attributes. Attributes are attached to variables, and dimensions kind of define the multi-dimensionality of the variable and how big the array is. And you have these data types orthogonally that define what type a variable is. So that's very simple. Then one, the classic netcdf model, there is the netcdf4 data model, which extends this idea by adding groups. So basically you can have a group is inside a netcdf file, and it looks a bit like its own netcdf file. So inside each group, you can have your own set of attributes, variables, and dimensions. Otherwise, you could not do that. So that means you could only have time defined once. Now you could have two different groups, and you can have two different times, for example, that then apply to variables of those different groups. Also, it adds new types, data types, extensions to the primitive types, and user-defined types as well. So in terms of parallel I/O, netcdf4 supports modes of parallel I/O. Classical way of accessing data in netcdf that is still often used is this kind of master mode. You have a single process that receives all the data and dumps it into a netcdf file. But this is a problem because we have this single point of network communication. And like I said, basically, if you have 1,000 processes or nodes, and you have just a single one dumping the data, you get only the network performance of this single link here, which is a problem. So in parallel mode, all these processes can write the data independently of each other using parallel netcdf and then write it to your parallel file system. Okay, that is pretty much it. So let's say thanks, EasyWays, for providing the funds for making such a lecture. And if you have any questions, we have now a little bit of time. No question. All right. So we will continue in a couple of minutes with Sadie's talk. And I'll just contact her about this. If you have, in the meantime, some questions, let me know. I would say we start.
Can you give a few more words about the easy ones, the previous page?
Oh yeah, I could. Oh, you're right. Oh, I actually missed this slide. I just figured I clicked too frequently. Let me add one more thing for the talk first, and then I answer that. So a very nice thing about netcdf is that you have a way to express this data model, the data models that you generate, and they are expressed in a common data form language, CDL in short. You can use this to generate new files with such a data model, or you can use it to analyze data. So here, if I look at a file, I see, for example, I have three dimensions, latitude, longitude, and time. So time is unlimited. The other ones have those two dimensionality. And then I see in terms of variables, what variables do I have? I have latitude, lat, which is a coordinate variable because I have the same dimension name over here. And this one depends only on lat as a dimension. I have long with long, time with time. So these are all coordinate variables. But for time, I know already time is the days since 1859 or something. And it uses Gregorian calendar, right? So this gives me some information. And lastly, I have the interesting variable that is rainfall, And this one here is defined about time, latitude, and longitude. So it's a 3D variable, and it its name is precipitation, right, according to some standard. And I also get some information about some title of this file and conventions. It uses CF conventions here. And lastly, you can actually dump the data, but I'm not going into this. So this is quite useful information. So now you said I should talk a little bit about EasyWays project. That makes absolutely sense. So EasyWays is a center of excellence according to Horizon 2020 projects. So that means it tries to bundle a little bit what this climate and weather community kind of need. And it aims particularly the large-scale simulations, pushing forward in our capabilities, research in this area toward exascale. So there are a lot of R&D and actually practical exercises as part of this Center of Excellence, and that should allow us to move the boundaries of simulations to even larger scale, right? You want to have more smaller simulations, smaller grid sizes, for example. You want to have smaller kind of time stepping in your numerical simulations. All this is tested as part of EasyWays, running the largest kind of large scale simulations. And there's, of course, community work involved, and also the summer school is really funded as part of EasyWays. And you will find more information on the webpage, which is easyways.eu. And it had it was funded for 3 years, no, 4 years in the first proposal. And now we are in the second phase, which is another 4 years of funding. What else to say? There are a lot of cool things at the webpage. I will type it as well on the chat. You can register for our newsletter. So I hope that answers the question. So can you use CDL to create a schema to validate NetCDF files? Very interesting question. I think certainly, yeah, you can use CDL to create a schema, right? What you expect. The problem with validation is, so what does it mean? Let's say take temperature, right? Maybe what you want to do is you want to say temperatures between minus 50 and plus 50 degrees are valid, or let's say minus 60 to plus 60. And everything that is minus 120 probably is a mistake. How would you validate that? So there is no, I'm not aware of any tool that does that automatically for you, so such that you could specify such constraints. However, I know that many tools, they would look into this carefully, and they would kind of indicate an issue if something is fishy. Probably there is such a tool out, but I'm just not aware of it. Okay, so I think the issue with Sati might be that she may have mistaken, because she's from the UK, the time zone, which means a 1 hour offset between us and her. And since that may have happened, I would kind of encourage you, while I try to reach her, to move on with this lab session that was scheduled at 15:30. And in this one, it is linked on the webpage. Yeah, I will answer the question in a second over here. So it's basically a 45-minute video that shows you how to use NetCDF, provides some more details, and walks through some issues. And even if you have no virtual machine now working, probably you can follow this manually, and I'll be around here in this chat to answer any questions that you may have. Yeah, so Elliot, yes, it's absolutely possible to modify NetCDF file sort of manually. There are different ways of doing it. One way is you can dump the NetCDF file as the CDL format, and then you change it, and then you read it back. That's one way. Then there are various editors that allow you to change individual data points, or you can write a little program in C that does that for you. So there are many ways of doing that. Lastly, there are also tools that read an existing netcdf file, such as the CDO tool. Then you can apply certain operators. You can say, for example, I want to dispose all the values that are less than 50 or whatever. And then they produce a new netcdf file. So editing a file is, in that sense, not often done directly, because you want to preserve the original state, treating the files as immutable. Okay, CDL is different tool. NCL, okay, so what is NCL? This is the, I think, NetCDF common language, and the NetCDF operators. There exists also CBO, or climate data operators. I'm sometimes not quite familiar with it, because I confuse a little bit these terms, because I'm mostly working on the boundaries to storage, yeah, and not an application user directly. But CDL, let me say this, CDL is really the basic idea from NetCDF. So it's actually lower level compared to NCL and NCO. Okay, so it was the idea of these guys that developed NetCDF to say, let's express our files, what they contain in terms of the data model. And you find this tool. So if you use a tool such as ncdump that you will find in this lab session, you will dump basically the metadata using this language. And this is, I think, really a good idea for them, that they have thought about this even 20 years ago, more than 20 years, 35 years or something ago. So I really like that. So, and with that, I hope that you will start and do a little bit this video, and you can do this in your own time.